So building this skill, intercultural competence, provides you some sort of direction so that when you're in front of other people, you feel more secure, relaxed, and confident. And then you can speed up. Again, you can get more out of this situation than when you are not relaxed. So what is it all about? First of all, understanding. We need to understand what people mean when we want to really learn more about them. And that takes effort. Okay. Secondly, obviously, we have to communicate with them. The tool and a part of culture for doing that is language. I'm sure you know that language makes a huge difference. When you go to a foreign country and you speak the language, it makes a huge difference. GCC is easy in a way because a lot of people speak English. But in certain areas, when you want to do something or you encounter people that don't speak English, then it's difficult, right? The language enables you building relationships, which are crucial to all of that, understanding, communication, and purchasing, venturing your goals, okay? Going for what you want. Let's say you want to do business, or you want to do any of your personal goals. You have to know how to communicate with people, you can understand them, and only then it can be effective in your actions. The components are awareness. First of all, you need to know that people think different, okay? Sometimes we forget, and I see a lot of, in Gdańsk, where I live, we have a lot of students from GCC, usually from Kuwait or Saudi. And they come, and they come just to a random grocery store, and they ask for halal food. And Polish people have no clue what halal is, you know? So those students were not prepared for that experience. They were not informed that, okay, Poland is not a Muslim country. We don't really have that as part of our culinary experience, that the food has to be halal. So most of the products in a random shop, they will not be halal, they will just regular. So awareness, curiosity. So we need to build. And for curiosity, we ask one question, which is, why? The whole psychology is based on that. Why? Until you get into the core of things. And then the learning process starts. You are aware that things are different. You have curiosity to find out more. And then you start to learn. And you learn by participating in the culture. We have different levels of learning, of building the competence. At the beginning, we have unconscious incompetence. So we don't know that we don't know, all right? So we just come to another country. Let's say we are from Bahrain. We are a student and we are joining the Naval Academy in Gdynia, in Poland, where we'll be studying for the next few years. And on the weekend, we're preparing, we're doing some grocery shopping, and we're going there to the shop looking for halal food. So people don't know that they're unaware. That's why they're surprised, they're shocked. How come you don't have halal food? How come you have never heard about halal food? What's wrong with you, okay? So they are not even aware that they don't know about the cultural differences. Later on, we start learning, and you know, after a few times they go to the shop, they face, you know, the people who are surprised. Then they learn that, okay, then they're conscious. Listen up, Dada, have you heard the Polish people don't know what halal is? Yes, I had the same. Okay, what do we do about it? I don't know, I will Google it, let's find the halal store online. Okay. So then they will start, you know, developing the awareness. And later on, it goes to another level, their conscience. That's, you know, in Poland, they don't have halal food. And Later on, after a few years they've been living in Poland, it's so clear and obvious to them that in every store in Poland, I mean, not every, but like, you know, every random store, they will not find halal food. So, you know, imagine you're the student after 4 years living in Poland, and then the new Ali comes, who's just a freshman, and he's looking for halal food. And they're like, what's wrong with you, Ali? You don't know that in Poland they don't eat halal food? Yeah, so this is the last stage, unconscious competence. So you don't even, are not thinking about it, it's automatical. Like when we drive the car, it's the competence that we've mastered. That's why it's just automatic. A little bit about myself and why I deal with culture. This is my life. I've been working with 100 different nationalities. I've traveled to 100 countries in my life. I've spent 10 years in the Middle East, in GCC. And I built my career on one skill, cross-cultural competence. I've always loved traveling. I've been interested in different countries, cultures, and people. So I ended up with a master in psychology, cross-cultural psychology, in fact. And I've been just working and traveling for different airlines in this region. Because that provided me with all this experience of being able to face people from different countries and cultures and interact with them. My favorite job was when I was recruiting for one of the airlines in the GCC, and I was traveling all over the world doing recruitment campaigns, facing all sorts of eager, beautiful people wanting to work in the GCC. And I felt like a child in a candy store. You know why? Because I was able to ask them anything I wanted. So that was absolutely awesome. So today, that's what I do. I still use that skills. I use the skills of knowing how to recruit people from different countries and how to differentiate between what is a skill and what is the influence of culture, okay? For example, when we recruit in Far East Asia, people are very, very shy. They're extremely modest. They do not maintain the eye contact because it's a sign of respect. Recruiters from the Western world and Western companies, they expect very aggressive approach, very strong self-PR, and then they don't perceive these candidates as worthy because they said, no, they cannot. They're not confident enough. You know, but they don't know that maybe they're just showing respect. So this is how the cross-cultural competence plays a role in recruitment. These are some testimonials. So I prefer Polish entrepreneurs who want to go to, usually it's Dubai, start business, and they're looking for business partners and are preparing for the talks, for the meetings, for negotiations. I coach them, I prepare them, I mentor them on how to do it, okay? So that they feel more confident and then they don't fuck up things. 3 weeks ago, I was in Poland with a client from GCC and he wanted to buy a property in Poland. So we went to a nice office with the nice ladies, nicely dressed with all makeup and informed. And she's informed that I arranged the meeting. I said, okay, I'm coming with Mr. Abdallah. And he's coming especially here for the to see your property and he's eager to buy. He wants to buy cash. So this is a serious client, right? And the lady said, okay. So we came to the office on a day. And have you been buying property or looking at properties in here, this part of the world? Who's done it? Yes? No? Ever? Okay, then I'll tell you how it is. Right. So basically when you're buying a property in the Middle East, the reception, the hospitality is great. People welcome you, they will offer you something maybe to drink, they will show you, okay, would you like to sit? This is our project, let me show you, you know, sit comfortably, I will show you around. How it is, and presents the entire project. They will describe it nicely for you, so you're just sitting there and you're being entertained. And if you like it, you decide, okay, here's my money, I'm buying it. But in Poland. In Poland, the lady with the employee, she says, okay, oh yes, yes, Ms. Kasia and Mr. Abella, okay, please welcome, this is her seat, okay. She didn't care that, you know, the client flew overnight from Middle East to make it on that day for the meeting. She didn't even offer, you know, tea or coffee, or didn't ask if it's comfortable. She was just, okay, I'm listening, what are your questions? And we don't know anything about the project. So the client had to really ask every single thing. Okay, tell us about the project, how are the apartments, you know, what is this, what is the price, what is this, what is that. So the client was asking and asking and asking the question because obviously he was curious, he was eager to buy, to know more. And at one point the lady was like, okay, do you have more questions? Because in 5 minutes I'm starting another appointment. Okay, Mr. Abdallah took the prospects, walked out of the office, threw the prospects out. Next day we went to another developer's office. The reception was better, even though it was poor. And he bought the property there. So that story shows you how important the awareness, cultural awareness is. Imagine you're that developer. You just lost the sale. So you can lose all of the things every day we're running after. Have you ever thought what is so important? Why do you get up early? Why do you push yourself? Why do you stay motivated in order to achieve what? It's all about health, sex, and money. And without having this competency, you will lose all of them. Every year, companies are sending employees to different parts of the world. And around 30% are terminating the contracts earlier because they cannot handle the culture. They cannot deal with people from different parts of the world. I've just checked this study about Polish companies venturing into the market in GCC. Also, 38% claimed that the culture and religion was the most difficult aspect. When you don't know how to deal with culture, as an employee who's being sent, for example, your contract is terminated, okay? You might get, that may affect your salary. When you're going to another country, have you ever lived abroad in another country? Who's lived abroad? Yeah, quite a few of you. Who has experienced culture shock? Who has experienced depressive moods? Right? So, you know, I've been also doing this repetitive around 5 times in my life. Every single time I had a culture shock, not to mention the reverse culture shock when you go back to your own country, which is even worse. Okay? It's very hard. So, if everyone, I hope no one has, because I don't wish that to anyone, but it's my experience, have been diagnosed with depression, we know how that affects our life, our well-being, our drive, right? So by embracing ourselves with knowledge, we can get prepared for that. Okay, let's look into the skills. So what does it actually mean? Adaptation skills, the way how you can start your journey, how you can address people, how you can make relationships with people, how easy you can adapt. This is all about having an open mind and willingness to learn. This will be driven by your attitude or modesty and respect. In different cultures, we show respect in different ways, correct? So in this part of the world, as we know, sometimes the men will not first extend a hand to shake it to a lady, it's the lady who's in science, right? Because it's a sign of respect. In Europe or USA, it will be totally different. If a man will not give the woman a hand to shake, she will say, oh, he's so rude. Yeah? So we need to learn about what are the standards in the culture that currently interests us. Okay, going back. Understanding the concept of culture. I've already mentioned that language is part of culture. What else? What is part of culture? Food, okay, yeah. Food, dress, yeah, our clothes, music, environment, social practice is very important. Yeah. Knowledge of the country and culture. So, relationship building, ability to talk to people, to make the relations, to build trust. Trust is the most important part in relationship building, as we know, and it's extremely important in business. Self-knowledge. How do you find out who you are? A lot of people I like who are just like this conference, Manama Entrepreneurship Week. I got really, really excited when I found out that court session, yoga, will be part of the agenda. Because it's the first conference I see that involves yoga. Yoga is a tool for self-discovery. It will allow you to quiet your mind, strengthen your body, and find out who you are as you practice it. I've been practicing for many, many years, and it helped me, especially when I was an expatriate living in this part of the world. So self-knowledge. Number 7, intercultural communication. So basically communicating with people, knowing about all these different, knowing that we are different, and still willing to learn. Still not being afraid to make mistakes. Still trying. Organizational skills. So all the transferable skills we learn in one job that we can transport them to any other workplace. And number 9, personal and professional commitments. Yeah, so how much are we willing to give up in order to get something? Even compliments. How we offer compliments differs in different cultures. So there's one compliment. Mr. Lee, your daughter is so beautiful. It makes me so proud. Yes, because they're two Chinese gentlemen. So Mr. Lee says, oh, your daughter is so beautiful, make you so proud. And Mr. Wang replies, no, not really. She's ugly. She has just good makeup. Okay, so this is the reaction to compliment. The same compliment, Mr. Lee says to Mr. Johnson from UK. Mr. Johnson, your daughter is very beautiful. Mr. Johnson says, thank you very much. She's not only beautiful, but she also was accepted to Harvard University this year. We're really proud of her. So we accept. And another one? Okay, in this part of the world, how do we react? This is a question for you.
Depends on the family.
Depends on the family, okay. Why?
Some parents have different perspective or express how their kids. Some would be accept them, some would be reverse.
Okay, so what are the two versions that we can come across in this, in Bahrain, let's say. Yes? Mr. Mohammed, your daughter is so beautiful. Okay? What will Mr. Mohammed reply?
Well, there's a general culture. white one. Which one? I find that depending on the relationship to spreading those, you're okay, there's interesting, but if you miss that, maybe seen as going beyond your limits.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because it's very personal.
Exactly.
So
yes.
We're talking about general culture, the Jewish people, or the whole society, not certain people who might their culture, but they might be Westernized or Easternized or whatever, or cosmopolitan or something. But if they are general, then maybe not, if you're not very close.
Correct, thank you. So you see how complicated it gets. It's absolutely true. In this part of the world, we don't have just one culture. Bahrain is a very multicultural place, and it is a very long multicultural tradition, it's over 400 years. So it's not so straightforward. And we have people who has been exposed to Western cultures, right, who come back from studying in US or UK, and then they go back differently. We have families who raise focusing on different values, okay, just within one culture. So imagine when we all mix this up. But just to make it simple, and talking about the general culture, like the gentleman mentioned, let's just agree on the, just for the sake of example, the same compliment for Mr. Abdad now, okay, so that's the general representative of the Muslim world. Sorry, GCC word. Mr. Abdallah, your daughter is very beautiful. So Mr. Abdallah will reply, Alhamdulillah, let the God provide her with good health as well. Right? You agree with me?
Yeah.
Yes? No?
Yeah.
Tell me, because I'm telling these things to Polish students. If I'm wrong, you have to correct me, okay? All right. So how culture works? This is an iceberg, and it works. Okay, so the idea is that 90% of the iceberg is underwater. This is the line of water. So what is above the water, this is what we can see, which is only 10% of the entire thing. So 10% we see, 90% is invisible, okay? And the whole rock formation is a culture. So what we can see, whatever is outside, when we enter a new country, first, when we travel, think about you yourself as a tourist. You go to a new country, and first of all you see, weather is good, weather is bad, okay? Then clothes, they wear different clothes. Then food, this is delicious, this is horrible, how they can eat this or that, all right? So these are all the external things that we see. But in order to really, really understand the mentality and communicate with people, we have to find out what is underneath the water. So the values, okay? What are the priorities and what are the assumptions? Many values. So just if you are to remember one thing from this presentation, please remember values are the key to understanding the culture. Jacques Cartier, when he was coming here to Bahrain in 1911, he was sitting with representatives of all the big families, business families, I know Zayani and some other ones. And you see what he was doing. He was sitting with them on the floor, eating local food. This is a great example of adaptation, okay? He didn't come up here in his nicely, nice suit, and they're like, we don't do it in France, okay, we do it differently, where are your chairs? No, he wanted to do business, he came here for the pearls. So he was sitting and eating, drinking tea, and building relationships, and then he did business. And in today's world, it works exactly the same way. So how do we do it? Just like I said before, before about yoga, we need to learn about ourselves. We need to develop the knowledge. Map home and team's cultural profile, how to benefit from cultural differences. So again, we need to be aware that the cultural differences are present and how we can take advantage of that, how we can utilize that. Another step, acceptance. So see the advantages and other values. Like we have multinational teams or students in the class. Everybody has, you know, their own background and can add extra value, something that we could never achieve if we just had everybody the same. And the last step, developing own intercultural behaviors. How do the big companies like Emirates, who is employing 200 different nationalities, how do they operate? Who knows? Taking in mind that, bearing in mind that they do have all these thousands of employees across all different places in the world, but let's just focus on the headquarters in Dubai. Yeah, we have 200 different nationalities, a couple of thousands of people. How do we manage them? Or any other company? Policies, SOPs, yeah. We develop corporate culture, so we agree on a certain code. Otherwise, it's impossible to run any enterprise. Those of you who do business, you know that, right? You need to have things that you will line up as your code of conduct, SOPs, whatever you call it, and that you will agree and people will stick to it.
Okay.
There's a few tips for you. I'm going to quickly run through them. Take responsibility for communication. You know, couples, they fight, right? Who has ever fought in a relationship? Yes? Okay, you're shy. Okay. all right. Especially relationships of different backgrounds, they have even more reasons to fight, okay? But what is more important than fighting is the resolution of the conflict. So how do we approach that? If you know how to fight, if you know how to come up, to understand your emotions, where it came from, and if you can discuss it, if you can just agree on something afterwards, it's great. So it's the same with communicating with people from different cultures. You need to take responsibility for communication. Do not judge, okay? So be curious, not furious. Don't judge people. They can behave and dress and speak in a different way. And just observe them initially. Ask, sometimes it's the intermediator. You might be, you don't want to offend someone, so you just observe and then you ask your colleague, okay, listen, is it normal she's dressed like this? Why is she dressed like this? Because I find it strange. Okay, and then just find out. Don't judge. Show respect. Of course, showing respect in different cultures looks different. So before you travel or before you go with doing business with people from different cultures, find out what is the norm in that country, how do they behave. And then also bear in mind, just like the gentleman has mentioned, that today we have hybrids. People are becoming hybrids, okay? They, let's say, are from this part of the world, but then they are westernized because of the education they received in the US. And then they come back. And then they are like hybrid. You know, from one way, they are very traditional. From, you know, in other areas, they will be absolutely westernized and, you know, thinking like people from the US, let's say. So we have to really have all of that in mind. Show empathy. Ambiguity tolerance is something very, very important. When I was doing recruitment, especially for the airlines, that was one of the components I have introduced for the entire team to look into, tolerating ambiguity, because this is a very crucial component of cross-cultural competence. Why? What is the, what does it mean? This is the ability to tolerate things that are unknown, uncertain scenarios, new situations. Okay, how do we behave when we are in a new place where we don't know what the SOPs are? We don't know what are the rules. We don't know how to behave. What do we do then? Okay, so ability to accept that stress, knowing how to deal with it. That's why, again, coming back to yoga, that's why I think yoga and meditation are such a great practices for business development, because they will allow you to reduce stress and then get in touch with your, not only in yourself, but with all the skills that you have as an educated and grown up person to deal with certain situations. Be patient and persistent, just like with anyone, everything, like with business, okay, it is not overnight, it's been said multiple times. Recognize your own cultural biases. So again, look into yourself, find out who you are, and see, why do I judge these people? Because of something I have in my head. If I have been raised, and people were saying like, oh, this is good or this is not good, I have this idea as a grown-up person, and I will be behaving the same way. Flexibility, just like in yoga, okay? So being flexible, being open for different solutions and scenarios. Show empathy, okay? Send clear message. I would say use simple language, okay? Language that will be understood. Increase your cultural sensitivity. Of course, you can do that through your interest, trainings. There's a lot of materials available on media, social media, YouTube these days. So the world is open, as we know. Looking at the individual. So do not judge. Like, oh, your entire country is, you know, packed up. Or, you know, I hate it, you're all the same. No, don't never generalize, because it will never help you. Look into the individual or individual scenario. And learn when to direct, okay? Again, a few more tips. Earning trust. Earning trust is crucial for developing business, as well as cross-cultural competence. Without trust, we cannot do anything, okay? Respect the differences. It is sometimes very hard. Like, a lot of people get disgusted when they go to China and everybody speaks, okay? But okay, when you learn why they do it, they're just scared of getting sick, so they're trying to remove, you know, all the phlegm, you know, in their throat. Not to keep it because they're scared of disease. So okay, it makes some sense, all right? But then that makes you a little bit more tolerant. Expect to be surprised. This is my favorite one. And this goes with ambiguity tolerance. Okay, when you expect that things will be different than what you're used to, that what you know, that what you're comfortable with, and you're really ready to deal with it. One big lesson I had from yoga, and that helped me also in building business, in working for big companies, was one simple sentence, okay? No expectations. It's extremely difficult, but just having this awareness, it helps. And prepare to adapt, of course, always. Yes, if you want to be like Jacques Cartier and buying the pearls from Bahrain, you need to know how to drink tea with Zayan, okay? Knowledge is more value than gold, so I highly recommend you to find, you know, to seek for the knowledge and to educate yourself and make a difference. That's all from my side. Thank you. Thank you.